Three tomatoes are walking down the street. Papa Tomato, Mama Tomato, and Baby Tomato.
Plain Ketchup presents.
Starring Lindsay Hinkle and Jamie Nelson.
So this is plain ketchup, is it? I prefer something with a little more kick.
Everybody's favorite condiment-themed entertainment podcast.
Put some hot sauce on that burrito, baby!
Hot sauce.
Nobody, I mean nobody, puts ketchup on a hot dog.
I'm Jamie Nelson, and you're listening to Hot Sauce on PlainKetchupPodcast.com. This month, we're talking storytelling.
I think one of my favorite examples of storytelling, like modern stuff, is the Dexter television series, and then also the book series that inspired it. Because they take the same characters and have kind of parallel universes with different storylines.
They do? In Dexter?
Yeah.
Are you sure you're not watching Fringe?
No, it's not within the show.
Oh.
The show is one storyline, but then the books that originated it have the same characters, but different things happen to the characters. So some characters who are alive in the show are dead in the books and vice versa. It's just really interesting to get to see these characters that I really like in all these different situations.
Mm-hmm.
And like they kind of, the character of Dexter himself, I would argue, even evolves in a different way from the television series and the book series.
That's interesting.
It's kind of cool.
So speaking of serial killers, wait, Dexter's not a serial killer, is he? Or is he? Yeah, because serial just means lots, right?
Well, yeah, it means that he kills repeatedly and in the same way. Usually have some sort of signature.
Oh, we have with us today an author who writes about a fictional serial killer.
Homicidal Florida file Serge A. Storms. Please welcome to the Skype studio, Mr. Tim Dorsey. How are you, Tim?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me. This is great.
So how is your good friend Serge these days?
Well, he's getting ready for the holidays. We have, when my publisher said that we wanted to have a Serge Christmas book this year, you know, in addition to the regular one that comes out in January, and I'm like, you know, did you call the right author? You know what my books are about, you know, and they said, no, we want, you know, and I'm like, well, because of the kind of edgy material, I have to take out a lot of the stuff that's, you know, the best parts of the books. And they go, no, leave all that in and just do a Christmas tale. And so I'm like, okay, you know, it's your funeral, you know. But no, they were very, very intuitive about this. I think it's a great idea. And so that's going to be coming out for the holidays, and it's called When Elves Attack.
Oh, very nice.
And I guess you can figure out who the elves are going to be.
For your listeners who have not read your books yet, could you tell them briefly who is Serge and what is his latest adventure?
Electric Barracuda is the latest release that's currently out. Following that will be the next installment, the follow-up to Electric Barracuda, which will be Pineapple Grenade. And the Christmas book especially, I mean, I was surprised, but once I got into that, it just kind of wrote itself. Sometimes, I mean, I shouldn't admit this, but, you know, with my characters like Serge and Coleman, once I get them going, I almost feel like it's cheating because I'm just taking dictation from them because I know them so well. I just set up a scenario and they just do their own thing. Basically, to pull back a little bit and give the quick tour of the books in this guy is that the star of all the books is actually the state of Florida. And that has to do with my just passion for all things Florida, and in particular, my inspiration, which is the great sort of subgenre of Florida authors we have, like Carl Hiaasen and Dave Barry and Edna Buchanan and Randy Wayne White and James Hall. They're all my heroes. I mean, just they, you know, inspired me, and that's why I wanted to, you know, follow in their footsteps. I've got this character that actually, he was just going to be a villain. He was going to not be very interesting and just be in the book, you know, in the first book. And what happened is, as I was doing the first draft, I was building his backstory to make him a larger-than-life, kind of a James Bondian villain, you know. And so in order to do that, I had him bumping off these people. And he's passionate about Florida history. He's always spouting it. And he kills these people because they're the people ruining the state that he so loves. I was working at the newspaper at the time when I was kind of motivating myself to have this guy do this really dark, nasty stuff to people. I thought of people who had sparked my sense of outrage covering the news, and basically people who exploited the elderly and all of these arrogant people who mainly it was white collar criminals. So I had him bumping these people off, and I'm like, this is way too much fun. this is the guy, and I think what led to it naturally was that Florida is just, we have a disproportionate, way off the scale, number of people who are just, just immoral as far as exploiting the weak and senior citizens.
Hmm.
A, I had no shortage of material, and then B, once these books started coming out, I had no shortage of people saying, I'm totally law-abiding, never done any, I root for this guy.
Yeah. What's the difference between your opinion of Florida and Surge's?
None. I mean, that's why he's so easy to write. He's just me. I just kind of like, well, and then I can always say, he's a fictional character. I would never do that or say that, but because he could do things that a good character couldn't do, because then you couldn't, have him continue to be a positive character. But you say, oh, well, he's the villain, and so he does these, I call it the Fonzie effect. The guy started out as a hooligan, a juvenile delinquent. But so anything he does nice, you kind of like it. And so that's how this guy has been kind of running along. But yeah, he's my mouthpiece for the things that I love about the state. And that's the beauty of, and one of the things that made me realize it, like an epiphany when I was writing that first book. Because he's highly intelligent. That's how he came up with the murder methods. But then I used that intelligence when I was building his story to spout Florida history. And he goes on these rants, and he just knows everything. And then that sealed the deal. I said, I really enjoy this because it allows me to cram in all of the little things that I really enjoyed growing up and revisiting. And I've made a connection with people on that level.
You said that, the main inspiration for your books is location. Do you also find yourself inspired by objects? Because it seems like Surge has a lot of stuff.
Oh, gosh. My wife would just laugh if she heard that question right now. She says, it's like when I used to play with my Barbies, because I had my souvenir collections out, and I'm reorganizing it, and I'm like going through and making sure I don't have duplicates, And it started with one big wooden box, and then it got to another big one, and these are antique boxes. And then it was like there was a lot of wooden old Ybor City cigar boxes. And now it grew to the point where I went and bought an antique bureau. And the bureau is full of wooden boxes. And one is matchbooks, and another is pins, and another is postcards. She just rolls her eyes and smiles and lets me do my thing. But yeah, I'm a big kid. And that's the thing that's great about this, is it allows me to indulge my childhood, it allows me to be immature, maybe, is a better way to put it.
Well, I think it was what Stevie Ray Vaughan's father told him probably also applies to writing, is Stevie Ray Vaughan said, I want to grow up and be a guitarist. And his father said, well, you can't do both.
That's a great line. That's a great line. And I'm fortunate. Who would have thought that it would lead to this? I mean, I never thought I'd have one book published, but that was my dream, I would just to convince somebody, and I would have paid them money, but here we are, going on the 14th and 15th books.
Lovely how the world turns out.
Yeah, be careful what you wish for.
Surge has a lot of creative ways of killing people. Do you come up with these when you're sitting down to write? Or I know a lot of authors will bring notebooks with them everywhere. Do you find yourself in the grocery store thinking, wow, that's a really interesting way to kill someone? How do you, separate yourself from that?
Actually, all of the book or books end up that way, which is what you described, away from the desk. Rarely, a very small percentage of what I think up happens while I'm sitting at the computer. As far as, the broad strokes, that's, while I'm in the shower, or lots of times I'm falling asleep, and I'll just be daydreaming, you know, I always keep a notepad next to my bed.
Do you have a favorite or funniest inspiration story, something that came from the book?
This was Nuclear Jellyfish, and it started up in Jacksonville, which I have a lot of friends up there and a lot of really kind readers. And I knew the place, and I said, I haven't done Jacksonville, so I went up there, and of course, I'm a big Lynyrd Skynyrd fan, and a lot of people think, you know, that they're from Alabama because of the song, but they're from Jacksonville, and so I knew that, and I studied. This is the example of a surgeon in his history, and I do this as well. He tracks stuff down, and I love it when you can't find stuff online because you can find just about anything on the internet. Well, he found out that. The song Gimme Three Steps, where this guy is dancing with this woman in the bar, and this guy comes up with a gun and says, Gimme Three Steps to the Door. Well, it found out that really happened to the lead singer, Ronnie Van Zant, and it inspired the song. This happened in like around 1970-ish, and I got the name of the bar, and the name of the bar had changed, and when I go look for this stuff, most of the time I find an empty lot or a Starbucks or something. And I go to libraries and I look in old phone books because that's the only way you can find this stuff.
Oh.
And I drove out. There's the place. And I went in and I introduced, and it was the dive. And I introduced myself to the bartender and started chatting it up. And she brought the owner out. The nicest guy. His name was Billy Bob. So I gave him, I signed a book to him, and he hadn't heard of me, but just totally hospitable. And he goes, well, shoot, man, do you have a couple of minutes? Let's go get in my pickup truck. And so we went out in his pickup truck, and he drove me around and showed, because he knew the family, and he gave me a Lynyrd Skynyrd tour. And we got out of the car, because this is where he grew up. He was a little kid, playing, Little League Baseball or whatever, and just took me to all the different stuff around West Jacksonville. And so I was going to ask him, I was going to say, yeah, I'd like to put your bar in the book. But then afterwards, I said, I'd like to have my characters come, into your bar, and I'd like to actually have a scene, and you can have a cameo. And he goes, absolutely. And I go, well, maybe you want to read my books first before you say yes. I'm sure it's fine. So I ended up having Serge reenact the song Gimme Three Steps with an actual gun that really fires. And he's in the book, and like I said, it's the real McCoy. It's the real McCoy Southern Dive Bar, right out of the Lynyrd Skynyrd song. And they had me in for a late night book signing, so it was one of the weirdest and greatest book signings I've ever had.
That's really cool. I didn't realize there was so much of it that was nonfiction.
You can't have Serge kill people like in a real motel. Because the owners might get a little upset. But if, you make friends like this, and they said, oh, no, definitely bring Serge in and have him, act up or whatever he's going to do in my bar or whatever, they go for it.
One of the things that fascinated me most was in Stingray Shuffle, there's a real metafiction going on. You've got your character, Ralph Crunkleton, who's written a book about a briefcase full of money, but he's also in your book, which is about a briefcase full of money, and you really sort of play with that and blur the line. So tell me about that.
That's a lot of fun, and I'll tell you a couple of places that I learned that from. Well, I've done it in earlier books, and then I did it a little bit more in Torpedo Juice, where I've got the narrator as a character, and he kind of pops in and out of being narrator and then being an actual character. In the book that you're talking about, the characters are in the book. They're reading the book, and the book is about them, because it's basically a book club, and they like to take literary vacations. So they're following the track of this book, and as they're reading it, they're in the book. So that sort of surrealistic kind of moving in and out of medium is Kurt Vonnegut was my main source of that. And of all things, Woody Allen movies, he also does that, where he steps out of character and he addresses the screen like in Annie Hall. And it's just great, and so that I learned it from those two people.
the theme of our month here is storytelling, and stories don't necessarily have to be just the books themselves. You also have book trailers online where it could just be the author saying, "Hi, I'm the author. I wrote this book. It's fiction. It's about this guy who goes around and kills people, blah, blah, blah." But you don't do that. You pretend you've borrowed Serge's car, sneaking into his house.
Oh, well, yeah. Again, I'm glad I have the guidance of people from my agent, my publisher, that as far as how to use the internet and social media and stuff. And so we do, you know, these little videos that are up online. Of course, I'm a terrible actor. That's why I write it. but they want me to, like, you know, okay, I'm in the book, and it's like Serge is my friend. You know, he's not, you know, this person I've created. So I mentioned, you know, he just left. You missed him. And so they want me to do is tell the story as if, like, not like I'm talking about a book or a product I have coming out, but as if I'm living inside the book with my character, which I think they came up with a great idea. And so, again, bending the medium. And I think if you notice the one in Key West, that's another bar that's kind of adopted me. I mean, and it's and so, you know, all the bar patrons took part in making of that video that was to promote the last book. And an interesting thing, I've got readers who go out and make videos based on the books, and so I've posted them. That's probably one of the most flattering things that I've had happen.
Do you think Serge will ever have his own Twitter account?
I was actually just talking about that with my wife about a half hour ago, because I said I think we need to start doing it in the book and then have it, like, extend out of the book and have him, you know, actually Twitter in real life, you know, what he's doing in the books, because it's becoming an integral part of life.
Yeah, and he's started the blog, and was that Nuclear Jellyfish?
Yeah, he started that. He had a website. I kind of didn't refresh it because, and of course, here's where you get yourself. You don't write yourself in a corner. You know, they talk about, you know, painting yourself in a corner. I mean, there's so much now going on with all the new media and the social media and everything. Is, you know, you've got to still have time to write. You know, and especially this year with two books. Which two books means two book tours, and which means, you know, the whole thing is like, you know, at the end of this, I'm going to go into a hyperbaric chamber, you know, take oxygen or whatever for a while, and then come back and write the next book. But, I mean, I'm just still pinching myself. It's all good.
There's definitely a character development arc going on with Serge. He's getting a little worried about aging and the types of madness that he has. Where do you see this development going, or Serge going, without, you know, giving away the ending, so to speak?
You don't need to read, you know, previous books in the series. But at the same time, you want to have, in addition to what's going on plot-wise, is you want to have character development, you know, continuing, you know, in an arc. But the problem is, I don't want my characters to get too old, because I've got a huge young audience, you know, and so I've got my characters, you know, at a certain age where, to me, I mean, gosh, I've been doing this for so long that I went from my mid-30s to now, I don't want to say where I am, but 50. I don't see him as old, but I'm keeping him there, but I'm having him, you know, think about stuff. Like in one book, he says, you know, I think I probably need to get married to, like, become more mature. And so that's one of the character developments underneath the plot in one of the books. And of course, you can imagine, it does not end well.
No.
So, and I had one guy write me saying, oh, I took that book and I highlighted, you know, the whole trip down the Keys, you know, the one where he gets married and whatever. And he goes, yeah, I'm going to use it because I'm going to use it as a blueprint for my honeymoon.
Oh.
I'm like, whoa, bad idea, fella.
Maybe he only got that far.
Hey, so you're on Twitter and Facebook.
I'm on Twitter and Facebook. We're ramping up more and more stuff in that department. My website is simplymyname.com. It's Tim Dorsey, TimDorsey. And I have just, as you alluded to, I have a massive amount of video and photography, et cetera, online to accompany the books, because, you know, I like the books to be very visual, and so, and to have a lot of real history. And so the web presence is a companion to the books and, you know, and the real history behind Serge's passion.
Right.
Which is, unfortunately, he ends up killing people as a result. But, you know, you it's a small price to pay.
Yeah. All right. So thank you so much for chatting with me, Tim.
You're talking like Coleman now. I really appreciate it, and I think it's a great show, and I'm honored you had me on.
Oh, thank you so much. Have a super night.
Alrighty.
Bye.
All right. Bye.